Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome back to Administrative Static. Well, it's been a bad week for the SEC. Cochran got taken, and this other case, Jarkesy v. the SEC, which is a case which is not our client, but as Peggy said in the first segment, did put in an amicus brief for us and Cochran. And this is a panel decision out of the Fifth Circuit, and it is a blockbuster for administrative law, and I don't think it can be underestimated. And Mark and I are going to explain the three big issues that the Fifth Circuit decided. But I just have to give you a little background.
The SEC, and that's Texas, Mississippi, and Louisiana for non-lawyers, just in terms of which states the Fifth Circuit covers.
Correct. And there was a case that everyone believed. The SEC, when you are in the securities business and the SEC comes after you, they can either bring a case against you in the district court or they can bring a case against you in before their own agencies and their ALJs, administrative law judges, that Mark and I discuss quite frequently. And either of these proceedings, they can take your license away and they can fine you and they can do all kinds of things. They can't do full disgorgement anymore after the Liu case because they lost that in the Supreme Court, but they can do some, okay? So they have some monetary things they can do. And if they proceed to go in before the Securities Exchange Commission, ALJs, you don't get a jury. We had the case right here at NCLA. We went down to Tampa and tried a case down there against the SEC, and we had a jury. And we had a jury because the court said that the SEC said, oh, no jury. But in that case, we did get a jury. And so just put that aside. So what's happened is that because of a case called Atlas Roofing versus Occupational Safety and Health Review Commission from 1977, it was a unanimous case. Justice Blackmun recused himself for some reason, but it was unanimous that when Congress makes a new remedy or a new law that has to be enforced or a new privilege, a public right of some sort, the agencies are allowed to adjudicate that without a jury. And Atlas Roofing has been expanded upon, and these agencies do not grant you jury trials. We were very fortunate that in Spartan, which is the case I'm talking about that we tried, the judge did grant a jury and over the government's objections, because they use this all the time, say no jury. So that's why this is one of the main reasons Jarkesy is a blockbuster case. He was brought before the commission on securities violations, securities fraud. And it doesn't matter so much for our purposes what that all was. But he said, wait a minute. A couple of things here. I don't know how you decide that I don't go to federal court and you decide that I go before the SEC ALJ. I don't get a jury trial and I deserve a jury trial. And in any case, your ALJs are wrongly constituted because they have too many protections of the president. They're the type of officers who the president should have to appoint and be able to fire. We've talked about that, like the Lucia case. We've talked about that quite frequently. So then out comes the Fifth Circuit with a blockbuster. And the reason I say this is because for all my plaintiff attorney friends and former colleagues, this opinion starts out with such a paean to jury trials, that jury trials are the greatest thing on God's earth. And they say how it's the only right that was in all the state constitutions when founded, how it nearly blew up the convention because it wasn't in the Constitution. And they go through Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, they go through everybody who talked about why you need juries and juries, not only in criminal cases, but in civil cases. And the first 10 pages of this case is all about how great jury trials are and how the founders thought they were great and how we wouldn't even have a constitution if you don't have a jury trial. So as you're reading this, you're like, oh, wow, this is really good. But if you're on the SEC side, you're like, this could be bad. Well, it does.
Because we don't have those.
We don't have those. But the thing is, so how do they get around Atlas Roofing? What the Fifth Circuit said is that this is fraud. Fraud is fraud. We've had fraud since common law times. This is not a new thing. This is not like an occupational, you have to have certain safety standards in your factory. And those standards are not just common law negligence. We're making higher and different standards, and now we're enforcing them on you under a federal OSHA statute. No, these fraud is something well known to the founders, well known to everyone, particularly securities fraud. If you don't think that they had securities fraud in the Bank of England and in London markets and New York markets in the 1800s. I think that you should take another look at plenty of it. So what they're getting at here is they say, so this is a common law tort. They knew all about this and you didn't give him a jury trial and you get jury trials. And sometimes the defense bar, the people who represent corporations hate jury trials. They're always like, oh, juries are terrible, blah, blah, blah. Well, I think in the Fifth Circuit, Every time someone's saying that there shouldn't be a jury or maybe the jury shouldn't be deciding this or that, I think this Jarkesy case is going to be waved around in more than just SEC cases, is all I have to say. It's really worth taking a look at.
Yeah, the language is pretty insistent.
Yes. And so the next one is so basically I'll just read a quick. Securities fraud actions are not new actions unknown to the common law. And so new actions that are statutory creations under Atlas Roofing and the precedent, those you don't get jury rights to. I think the big argument down the road is going to be, are these akin to? Okay, they made it look new. They made it under statute, but is it really something else? But well, that's for another day. The next blockbuster ruling in this Jarkesy opinion is that Congress did not, this is non-delegation. We haven't had, I can't think of a case where someone said that Congress did not give an intelligible principle, meaning they didn't, when they gave away their power to the executive to do something, they didn't tell the executive what the standards were. And here the SEC says, we have no idea how they decide. And Congress gave them no understanding of when you should have the case go before the SEC and when you should have the case go to federal district courts. Since that is completely unknown, since there's no intelligible principle, and they cite Gundy and they cite the majority in Gundy actually. And Gundy was a case that ruled 5-4, not overturning, not finding there was non-delegation because Alito wouldn't go there. But it does show that the non-delegation doctrine, It is starting to have teeth. This is the only appellate decision I can think of that really turned on it. And the Fifth Circuit dropped a footnote because they had now two holdings. There's a holding you need a jury for fraud, and there's a holding that the decision about putting it in the SEC and not putting it, and having these type of proceedings, there's no standard for it. And so, there's no standard for what you're supposed to do. Well, the Fifth Circuit said, and both of these, none of this is dicta. Everyone's bound by all of this because we have an alternative holding. And then the third holding is that the ALJs themselves have too many protections. Right. Mark? Why is that? What does that do?
Right. So there's a couple of prior decisions from the Supreme Court that sort of combine in this instance, there's the decision from Free Enterprise Fund v. PCAOB that John mentioned in the previous segment, in which the court decided that you cannot have multiple layers of protection from removal by the president if you're a federal officer, And then there's the decision, Lucia v. SEC, which decided that these ALJs are federal officers. And they decided that in the context of saying that they had to be appointed under the appointments clause. In other words, they had to be appointed by the president or by the head of the agency. They couldn't be appointed by the head ALJ, as the SEC had been doing. And so when you take those two things together, you say that that federal officers have to be appointed, and then they can't have these multiple layers of protection. Well, guess what? Those two things are happening at the SEC. They have multiple layers of protection, because in order for the president to remove an ALJ, he can't do it directly. The ALJs are protected from removal by for-cause removal protection. They can only be removed not on the whim of the commissioners, not on the whim of the president, but only if there's a showing and a hearing that they have failed to discharge their duties in an appropriate way. And then the folks who make that decision, the Merit Systems Protection Board, this is the group that oversees not just the SEC ALJs, but a whole lot of civil servants. The MSPB has to decide and make a recommendation to the commission that this person has not discharged their duties in an appropriate fashion. And then only if the MSPB decides that, then the commission, the SEC commissioners, who are also protected from removal, the MSPB commissioners are protected with for-cause removal, the SEC commissioners are protected with for-cause removal, and then they have to act on the MSPB's recommendation. So if you're lost by now, you understand how many layers of removal there are between the president and one of these ALJs. And so the Supreme Court has said in other contexts, this is a no-no. But the SEC has, and the SEC can't fix this on their own, John. That's one of the problems here. This is statutory. The statute that governs says that these multiple layers of protection exist. So Congress is going to have to get involved here if the Supreme Court upholds what the Fifth Circuit has decided. So we've laid out the issues, John.
Yeah, we'll discuss it further in the next segment, because now you know what the case held. There's a lot going on there.
Well, we're back on Administrative Static to continue talking about the Jarkesy v. SEC bombshell from the Fifth Circuit that came down this week. And John, there was a curious footnote in this decision that says, because we vacate the SEC's judgment on various other grounds, they're referring to the jury trial ground and the non-delegation ground, we do not decide whether vacating would be the appropriate remedy based on this error alone. Meaning the removal protections error that we were just talking about. See Collins v. Yellen, remanding to the district court to determine what remedy, if any, is appropriate in light of the Supreme Court's holding that removal restrictions applicable to the director of the Federal Housing Finance Agency were unconstitutional. And there's two things that are interesting to me about that, John, and you may see this differently, but the first thing that's interesting to me is Collins, as I just read, remanded to the district court to determine what remedy is appropriate. Well, that's often done. Courts of appeals often will remand things to district courts to determine the remedy in the first instance. But there was no district court here, if I'm not mistaken.
No, it's straight from the SEC. We were talking earlier that sometimes you get appeals. Once you go through it, you go straight to the circuit. That's what happened here. There's no district court to remand it to.
Exactly. This is a petition for review of an order of the SEC, a final order of the SEC. So the only place that's being remanded is to the SEC itself to determine what remedy, if any, is appropriate. And well, first of all, if the SEC says, no remedy is appropriate, really? That would be an interesting finding. You're going to trust the SEC to decide that no remedy is necessary here. Or if the SEC were to decide, for example, that, you know what, we do need to have just one layer of protection from removal or what have you, that's not within the power of the agency to do that. So what do you think's going on, John?
Well, here's the thing. what I was thinking is it, the commissioners haven't been struck down, right? I mean, they can't send it down to the commission and have an ALJ do anything right now. It strikes me.
Ah, but the SEC commissioners themselves.
The commissioners could hear things, right?
They can. They sure can. Yeah. So that is an option.
So what I think is happening here,
they have more expertise in securities law than the ALJs, by the way. That might come as a surprise to people, but it's definitely true.
And so the thing is, so they have to put it in the actual commissioner's hand, because it strikes me that this opinion takes things out of, you don't want the ALJs doing anything because it might be unconstitutional, and it looks like it is in the Fifth Circuit. So if the ALJs are officers not allowed to do this, well, who is? It's got to be the commissioners. So he's remanding it to the commissioners. Okay, here's the ruling. Now you figure out what you're going to do. And if Jarkesy doesn't like it, he can come back.
Right. So the commissioners could do at least two things. They could say, okay, henceforth, we're going to abolish hearing these things from the ALJ, and we're going to hear them ourselves. Now that doesn't solve the lack of a jury trial problem, but it does solve.
But couldn't they impanel? Here's the thing. Could they impanel a jury? They don't have, I don't think they can, because I don't think, I mean, just the process of calling jurors, you know how hard that is for the court. The courts have whole processes to know who they are and how to do it. SEC doesn't know how to call a jury.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's a wrinkle. That's definitely a complication here. So assume that the commission heard them directly. That would at least solve the multiple layers of protection from removal problem.
Yes, I think it would. I think it would also make the job a lot harder for these commissioners. They're really going to have to work.
I'm sorry. Am I supposed to cry a tear on that? I got an email from a former commissioner at the SEC yesterday, John, that just said woohoo. So I think that there have been commissioners at the agency over the last couple of decades who've recognized this problem, but they also weren't in a position to do anything themselves. So I suppose one thing the commissioners could do is that they could petition Congress and say, look, Congress, there's a problem here and we can't fix it. You have to be the ones to fix it. So that could be a salutary result of this decision.
Yeah, it could be. Now, what do we do about the jury trials? Now, there's two things that go on here. What can the SEC still do? Put the ALJ problem aside. Let's say the Fifth Circuit, let's say the panel is upheld, because that's the other thing. I assume they're going to ask for en banc review, I assume, before they go to the Supremes. But the circuit split is obviously big now, so they could go directly to Supremes, the SEC. But what can they actually do? And it strikes me what they can do is they can find what they adjudicate that are obviously public rights, right? So if you have to have a license that the SEC gives you, licenses are, I think it's pretty well established public rights. I think licenses from the government to do stuff only the government can let you do is a public right. So I think they can still do that. But again, I think only the commissioners can. So they can take away your license.
When you say they can do that, you mean without a jury, they can do that?
Without a jury. So there, and I can't think of all the other things right now offhand that are public rights, but
can't find somebody.
They can't find someone. They can't take their money, I don't think. So the point is there are things the SEC can do. No one wants their license pulled, but And what about these quasi group? What about FINRA? You know, that's a private entity.
I mean, they've got enough to worry about with that, with just this decision. I don't think FINRA is implicated directly by this decision.
But what I'm getting at, there are licensing. What else is there? What's another public right? I'm not sure, but that's their core.
Well, inspection, I suppose. I mean, they've got some other authorities, right?
True. They can always look for violations. That's true. So it is going to definitely, there must be full on panic over there. I can't even imagine what it's like to be a lawyer over at the SEC right now. And I am not accustomed to, having any, soft feelings for that crowd, but holy mackerel.
I think it's safe to say they haven't been this panicked since they lost 13 of the 14 counts in the trial at Spartan Securities, John, that you were a part of.
Maybe. But, or the ability. Yeah. Or I think Lou also shocked them that they can't just make up any number they want and call it disgorgement.
Right. Right. Well, one of the ballyhooed features of the Dodd-Frank Act back when that was passed during the Obama administration was that it increased the number and kind of matters that the SEC was allowed to adjudicate internally. And before that, there were some of these things they had to take to federal district court. And Dodd-Frank gave them a lot more discretion over whether they wanted to do something in-house or not. And I think that the Congress is going to have to revisit that aspect of the Dodd-Frank Act under the, at least if this decision's upheld, and they're going to have to either create juries or take some of those things away from the SEC. Because I think that the Dodd-Frank Act made this particular aspect of the statute worse. This particular aspect, I'm not saying that this jury's problem, as I said in the previous segment, I'm not saying that it hasn't existed for decades, but I think it got substantially worse after Dodd-Frank.
Now, how about non-delegation? Here's my thought on that, Mark. I think that it's a blockbuster on non-delegation because it has always been opaque to me in these agencies where they have memos with justice about who prosecutes where and whether it's in the agency or it's somewhere else. I mean, FTC, antitrust, just think of that. Sure. If this goes...
Although Axon was challenging that, I believe.
Yeah, they were. But I think that if the Supreme Court takes this, I don't think they're going to be this ambitious. I think they'll approve one or the other and then say, we'll worry about this in another time. And what I'm worried about, although, I mean, it's early days, but I'm worried about that they'll make a decision on juries and then they're not going to put the footnote the Fifth Circuit put in about non-delegation. They're going to hold off on non-delegation. That's, you're going to get cert petitions on everything, but they either just take it or they don't rule or they find they don't have to rule on everything, which would be a shame because it would be nice to know the answers to these three questions.
Well, how are they not going to decide all three? Because in the Fifth Circuit, all three are independently relevant. So it seems to me, maybe there's a way to do it, but so you could imagine that they sever the statute, right? Because we've seen them do that before.
Yep.
Even in very complicated cases, we saw that in U.S. v. Arthrex. So they could try to sever one of the, and this gets back to the issue I was talking about, the protection from removal. They could sever some of the protection from removal. But what do you sever, John? Do you sever, because Congress created all of these protections. So what gives the court the right to say, for example, we're going to do away with the ALJ's protection from the Merit Systems Protection Board, or we're going to do away with the for-cause removal protection for the ALJs, or we're going to do away with for-cause removal protection for the members of the Merit Systems Protection Board, or we're going to do away with the for-cause removal protection for the SEC commissioners themselves. I mean, there's about four or five different layers there, and to get to one, you've got to do away with three or four layers.
What did they do? That's a lot of surgery. What did they do with the patent board? Because this question came up in that patent case whose name is escaping me. It's
yeah, that's Arthrex. That's Arthrex. What they did there was they said they turned them into inferior officers by saying that all the decisions had to be reviewed by a higher up. But all the decisions of the are already reviewed by higher ups here. So it was a slightly different issue. It was it wasn't quite the same multiple layers of protection from removal. It was very easy to get them down to one layer.
So we'll see what happens.
Let me correct myself. I said that wrong. They didn't reduce the layers. They turned them into inferior officers by having all of their decisions reviewed, so that the person who reviews the decisions is essentially removable by the president. So that's what you could do here, I suppose. You could say that the SEC commissioners can review and then the president can just fire them at will. But I don't think the SEC commissioners would be very happy with that, John.
No, they got a lot on their plate right now from this thing. Holy mackerel. Well, lots of good news this week. Lots of good news. So hopefully
our cup runneth over. Reading,
but hopefully next week is good. We'll see ya.
Hope you have as good a week as we did.